praise in the house. For this is the day the Lord has made, and we will rejoice and be glad in it. Let us stand for our call to worship, which is found in your bulletins and also on our video screens. Oh God, you pour out the spirit of grace and love. Together, we may worship you in spirit and in truth. Amen. Reverend Sean Drains will come to lead us in the hymn of praise. Our prayer of invocation will be delivered by the Reverend Dr. Deborah Grant. And then the choirs of Flipper Temple will lead us in music. And the Reverend Dr. John Green will lead us in the Hebrew scripture. And Reverend James Alexander will lead us in the New Testament lesson. And our worship will proceed as outlined.
My beloved brothers and sisters, let us come together singing hymn number 210, led by the minister of music and the choir.
My comfort by day and my song in the night. My hope. My salvation. My all. God, we come to this place in the spirit of worship to magnify, glorify, and lift up your holy and righteous name. We call upon you, O God, to set our minds right for this worship experience. And we call upon your presence to move in us and on us and through us so that we might be transformed by the life-giving word of God. Come, Holy Spirit, in this place. We welcome you, Holy Spirit, in this place. In this place on tonight. Deliver us and refresh us in this place and refuel us in this place and redeem us, oh God, tonight, so that our lives will not be the same as it was when we walked into this door. We thank you, God, for yet another opportunity to worship and magnify your name. And because of it, we will bless your name all the days of our lives. In Jesus' name we pray. Let the people of God say amen, amen, and amen. We'll be right back.
Hebrew reading from the New Revised Standard Version of the Bible, Isaiah 40th chapter, beginning at verse 28. Have you not known? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He does not faint or grow weary. His understanding is unsearchable. He gives power to the faint and strengthens the powerless. Even youth will faint and be weary, and the young will fall exhausted. But those who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. The word of God. Amen.
Let us hear the New Testament as it comes to us from the book of Romans, the 8th chapter, beginning reading verse 31. What shall we then say to this? God be for us. Who is against us? He did not spare his own son. He gave him up for us all. That we will not also give us all things with him? Who shall bring charges against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is it to condemn? It's Christ Jesus who died. Yes, who was raised from the dead, who is at the right hand of God, who indeed intercedes for us. Who shall separate us from the love of God, of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress, or persecution or famine or nakedness, or peril or sword? As it is written, for thy sake all day long we are regarded as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all things we are more than conquerors through him who loves us. For I am sure that neither death nor life, nor angels nor principalities, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor heights, nor depths, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus, our Lord. Where God's people die.
Good evening, saints.
Good evening.
Aren't you glad to be in the house of the Lord tonight?
Amen.
I realize we sit up here in suits and everything, so maybe we don't feel like moving because God has not been good to you since this afternoon. But if I could just get somebody to just stand on your feet and give God a worthy praise. Let's put your hands together for God tonight. See, I realize you might not have known that first song. And that first song says, "Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good." Amen. Has he been doing things? Well, good. We're going to sing a song now. We want everybody to kind of help us out. It's a familiar song. It's Lift Him Up. Y'all know Lift Him Up. It's a hymn called Lift Him Up. And we want you all to come on and join in with us. We're going to sing the first two verses. First, chorus, chorus. And then you all stay standing and praise God tonight. How about that? All right. Please welcome to the mic Sister Ari Johnson. Go ahead and give her a hand.
Thank you. offering tonight, we are combining the missionary offering and the general offering. And so we're going to ask of you tonight for a minimum gift of $25. Now, if you want to give more than that,
amen,
we will kindly receive it. And then there might be some special gifts tonight for Turner Seminary. We don't reject that. We welcome that tonight. But I'm going to ask us to continue in this spirit of active worship. I'm going to ask that the officers or the ushers would just stand here with the receptacles. And what we're going to ask you to do tonight, in the tradition of African American worship, we're going to ask you to get up and bring your gifts. This choir has been singing tonight. I'll say it again, this choir has been singing tonight. And I believe that they can give us some good old-fashioned marching music, some happy money-giving music. Amen. The Lord loves cheerful, happy. The Lord blesses cheerful givers. So we're going to ask you to stand on both sides, and that you would bring your gifts tonight. $25. Get broke everywhere else but church. Amen. But if you have a special gift tonight, we would be glad, we would be happy to receive it for the seminary. If not, let us pray the prayer. All things come to the Lord of the Holy Spirit.
Trying to do
St. Paul Church. And every now and then I get a chance to go to Virginia, so I got to go by and see this city of possibility that they are building. He is a master pastor. Motivates and challenges people to do their best and to reach and fulfill the potential that God has given to them. So we're blessed tonight to have a preacher and a pastor in the house, a model for ministry. And I just believe that God has given him a word for us. And I don't know about you, but I'm ready to hear a word. I mean, I'm ready to hear a word from the Lord. I had to meet with some lawyers this afternoon, and that turned me off. Then I made a mistake of turning on MSNBC and seeing what our international embarrassment's done today, and that turned me off. So I'm ready to hear a word from the Lord. Anybody here ready to hear a word? Following the singing of the choir, the next voice you hear will be God's servant, the preacher for the hour, the Reverend Dr. Lance Watson. Whosoever has ears to hear, let him hear.
Oh, Crossed over. He did this so that all the peoples of the earth might know that the hand of the Lord is powerful. And so that you might always fear the Lord your God. And all the people said, amen.
Amen.
If you're near somebody tonight and you don't mind, just look over at them and say, neighbor,
neighbor.
Don't forget to remember.
Don't forget to remember.
Amen. That's what we like to talk about tonight, with the aid and assistance and anointing of the Holy Spirit. Don't forget to remember. For a book about conquest, the book of Joshua surely skimps on military details. What weapons did he use? How many army officers did his army have? How many people made up each battalion and each unit? Did Joshua have an elite delta fighting force? If so, what training did he require them to go through? The answer to these and so many other questions, we don't know. And we don't know, quite honestly, because the emphasis in the narrative is not on the physical battle, but on the spiritual one. The real conflict of the Israelites wasn't with the Canaanites, the Hittites, the Jebusites, or the Amorites, but it was with Satan and his demons. Canaan was the richest and choicest real estate on the planet. It connected the continent of Africa with Europe. It accessed the Mediterranean Sea. It was marked by fertile fields and lush valleys. And more importantly, the land was God's gift to the children of Abraham. Nearly seven centuries earlier, God had told Abram in Genesis 12:7, to your descendants I will give this land. God set this property apart for his people, and his people apart to be a blessing to the world. God promised Abraham, I will make you into a great nation. I will bless you and make your name great, and you shall be a blessing. This amalgamated assortment of bad lands, Bedouins, would become the couriers of God's covenant to a galaxy of people around the globe. Israel would be the parchment on which the redemption story of heaven would one day be written. The city of Jerusalem, the town of Bethlehem, the sacrifices of the temple, the prophecies of the prophets would all unfold on this land. The Redeemer would be born here, would walk here, would live his life here. He would soak this dirt with his blood and shake this ground with his resurrection. The book of Joshua then isn't about claiming real estate for a dislocated nation, but rather it's about preserving a stage for God's redemption plan. And Satan's counter strategy was clear: contaminate the promised land and preempt the promised child. Destroy God's people and dismantle God's work. And so Joshua's battle, much like ours, can I suggest, was a spiritual battle. Because our fight is not against people on earth, but against the rulers and authorities and the powers of this world's darkness, against the spiritual powers of evil in the heavenly realm. And that is why, no matter how long we have been in the faith, no matter how steep we are in the tradition, every day that God opens our eyes, we should put on the whole armor of God. Tap somebody next to you and say, all of it. Amen. That's Ephesians 6:12, where Paul says, then on the day of evil, you will be able to stand anything. And when you have done all to stand, stand. Now, I recognize that the idea of evil, abstract or incarnate, strikes many of us moderns as odd, antiquated, old-fashioned, and outdated. Because the popular trend of our time is to blame all of our problems on genetics, government, God, and the environment. Yet the Bible presents, through its narrative, a very real and present foe to our advance and to our faith. And the scriptural writers personify that presence and name it as Satan. Yes. Some call him the devil or the adversary. Others call him Belial or Beelzebub, the tempter, the evil one, the accuser, the prince of demons, the ruler of this world, the prince of the power of the air. But whatsoever name you choose, he is the enemy and he is real. He is not the cute and harmless character of our cartoons. He is not an imaginary dark counterpart to the Easter Bunny. He is the bunny. He is the invisible, yet forceful fallen angel called Lucifer, who desired the high place that only God could occupy. He rebelled, he disobeyed, and he fell, and he wants you and I to do the same thing. Tap your neighbor and say, don't take the bait. Amen. 1 Peter 5:8 says, the devil, your enemy, goes around like a roaring lion looking for someone to devour. And any person who has ever dared drawn near to God has already felt the enemy's attack. His rap sheet is clear. Can I read a few of his charges? In 1 Chronicles 21:1, Satan incites David. In Luke 22:31, Satan asks to sift Simon like he was wheat. In John 13:2, the devil persuaded Judas Iscariot to betray Jesus. In Luke 13:16, there was a woman that Satan had kept bent over and bound for 18 years. In Ephesians 2:2, he rules the power of this world, and his spirit has power over everyone who has not surrendered to the power of Christ. The Bible says that Satan incites, he sifts, he persuades, he binds, he blinds, and he rules. And he has three primary objectives, and this is Jesus speaking in John 10:10, the thief comes to steal, to kill, and to destroy. And I've got news for you tonight. He's ticked off at you. All this talk about deliberate leadership and new paradigms to change the Church of Christ and take it forward into the future. All of this conversation about the rest of your days being the best of your days has left your enemy in a foul mood. Your days struggling did not trouble him. Your nights lost, confused, angry, and disappointed did not bother him. But now you have the nerve, the unmitigated gall to think about, talk about, and step towards God's fortuitous future for your life, your ministry, and your church. You dare to walk in faith and not fear, to lean on grace and not live in guilt, to hear God's voice more and listen to the enemy's voice less. I need to tell you squarely that the enemy has you in his gun sights. You are on the devil's hit list, but don't be scared. You're still on Jesus' mailing list. There's a target on your back. You are in enemy territory just as Joshua was. Because for the first time in nearly five centuries, Hebrews were camping in Canaan. This was the moment that they had been waiting for. This was the hour that they had dreamt about. How many times had they gazed across the Jordan at this lush land? And some of them, old timers like Joshua and Caleb, had been waiting for 40 years. And somebody listening to me here tonight knows what it is to have to hold on to a single promise from God for a long time. When God opened the waters of the Jordan River, they didn't have to wait to be asked twice. Joshua 4:13 reports it well, that all told, about 40,000 armed soldiers crossed over before God onto the plains of Jericho. They were ready for battle. They hurried across with a shout, a roar, and a holler. And had not God stopped them, they would have run straight on in to the fortified city of Jericho. But God did stop them, because what they didn't realize is they weren't quite ready yet. It's as if God wanted to give them one more word. And I'm thinking here of my mother, all 5'1", 100 pounds, soaking wet, who brought 17 children into the world with my dad. I'm thinking of my mother, who every day when she said,
sent us to school on the first day of school, her message would be exactly the same. With lunchbox full, breakfast not eaten, jackets and school supplies in tow, all of us excited after the summer to get out of the door, she would stop us all on the front porch. And after a while, we knew what to expect. She would get eye level with each one of her kids, causing the tall ones to stoop and the low ones to reach. And she would say the same thing to every one of us. She would say, remember what I taught you. Remember who you are. Remember whose you are. You are a Watson, and you bet not embarrass this family. See, that's exactly what God did in the text right here. God brought this impending invasion to a halt. And by virtue of a couple of commands, he prepared the Hebrews for the promised land. I'm in verse 1 of the text where it says, and it came to pass when all the people had completely crossed over the Jordan that the Lord spoke to Joshua and said, take for yourselves 12 men from the people, one from every tribe, and command them, saying, take 12 stones from the midst of the Jordan, from the place where the priest's feet stood firm. You shall carry them over with you and leave them in the place you lodge tonight. Joshua assembled and commanded a dozen men, one from each tribe, to return to the riverbed, to the very area where the priest had stood. Those men dislodged 12 huge stones as the people watched and the waters resumed their flow. Joshua began to stack the stones. When the 12th stone was stacked securely, placed in the top spot, he turned to the people and urged them, when your children ask you in the future, what do these stones mean? I want you to tell them Israel crossed the Jordan on dry ground. Well, what is the secret to survival in enemy territory? I won't keep you waiting long, because the first thing I want to remind you of, if you're going to survive moving forward rather than living backward, you've got to remember what God has already done. Would you just tap your neighbor and say, don't forget, neighbor. Hold on, brother, I ain't tell yet. Amen. See, but look, you got to remember what God has already done. Remember and record his accomplishments in your mental memoirs. Capture every crossing somewhere in the scribe or a script of your soul. Before you look forward to whatever your next Jericho is, look backward to your previous Jordan and remember what God has already done there. At least be as consistent as Facebook. I don't know how many of you are techno pastors, but I'm a techno pastor, and Facebook has a feature they've been putting on display for the last 5 years where they will go back without your permission into your postings and pull up texts and pictures and posts and quotes that you may have shared 2, 4, 6, 8 or years ago, and they will remind you of what you were thinking, what you were saying, how you were looking, and what you were doing at the time. And that's the minimum that each of us should do in our relationship with God. Somewhere in your archives, you ought to have some snapshots, some text messages, some posts, some reminders of what God has already done for you. And periodically in your life, you ought to pull them up. Some years ago, my daughter reminded me of this truth. I was driving her to school, and she noticed that I wasn't talking like I used to. She said, Daddy, why are you so quiet? I told her, well, I've got a lot of deadlines that I'm a little concerned about that I have to meet. And kids aren't always clued in to what their parents are going through. So she immediately jumped into the conversation. She said, well, can I ask you a few questions? I said, sure. She said, have you ever had deadlines before? I said, yes. She said, how many have you had before? I said, I don't know, maybe hundreds, maybe even thousands. She said, well, have you ever missed any of those deadlines? I said, not for the most part. She said, so let me clarify. God has helped you to meet hundreds, maybe thousands of deadlines before. I said, yes.
She said, well, it seems to me, I know I'm young, but if God has helped you to meet hundreds, maybe thousands of deadlines before, don't you think he can help you one more time? Translation, she was saying, you need to stack some stones, Dad, because hear me tonight, preachers, Satan has no recourse to your testimony. Your best weapon against his attacks is a good memory. Don't forget a single blessing. Remember, God forgives sins, everyone. God heals diseases by his grace. God redeems our life over and over. God crowns us with love and mercy and joy unspeakable. God wraps us daily in his goodness all the days of our lives. God renews our youth so that it's like the eagles. God restores our joy every time we ask. God sustains our peace even in the midst of trouble. God will make everything come out right, work out right, end up right every time. Won't he do it? Psalm 103, verse 6. I love that text. It says, he puts victims back up on their feet. You ought to create a trophy room in your heart. And every time you experience a victory, put a memory up on your shelf. Before you face whatever your next challenge, your next crisis, your next contest is, take a quick tour of God's accomplishment. Look at all the paychecks he provided, all the blessings he has given, all the prayers he has answered. Think of all the sickness he has healed and burdens he has lifted and ways he has made and doors he has opened and battles he has fought and wrongs he has righted and enemies he has silenced and problems he has solved and victories that he's given, and give God praise for what he's all that he's done. You can imitate that shepherd boy hero David. Before he fought the giant Goliath, he first remembered how God had empowered him to fight a lion and a bear. Don't miss that on Founders Day. He faced his future by remembering his past. And that's what we've got to do. Don't go to Jericho until you've remembered your Jordan. Can we attack now, Joshua? The stones are stacked. The moment is memorialized. Can we attack now? Joshua said, not quite. God has another instruction for us as Hebrews before we initiate this next battle. You've got to remember what God has already done, but then remember whose you are. I'm in verse 2 where it says, at that time the Lord said to Joshua, make flint knives for yourselves and circumcise the sons of Israel again the second time. 600 years earlier, God had inaugurated this practice of male circumcision among the people of Israel. Circumcision, God told Abraham, will be a sign of the covenant between me and you. 8 days after the birth of every male child, they were to be symbolically set apart by having their private parts altered. They were not to be like the nations that surrounded them, but this physical act was to symbolize that they were children of the covenant. They were a part of an incendiary fellowship of faith. This act symbolized that they belonged to Jehovah. And during the wilderness wanderings, the Hebrews let the practice lapse, and it's not hard to see why, because with hearts hardened, the people ignored this instruction, and they might have been tempted to ignore it again. Because after all, this act would leave the men convalescing for weeks. Their wives, their children, their property left unprotected. Enemy nations were watching their every move. Shouldn't the men remain at maximum ferocity so that they could fight potential enemies? And yet, notice in the text that God was not concerned with their muscles, their brawn, their skill, or their numbers. He wanted them, before their next conquest, to remember whose they were.
specifically that God, according to Joshua 5:9, had rolled away the reproach of Egypt. That phrase, the reproach of Egypt, was a reference to the humiliation of the slavery that had made them subject to insult and disgrace from other nations. And it was time for them to reclaim their birthright as God's chosen people. And I say it's high time for you and I to reclaim ours. Because circumcision was about identification, but it was also a symbolic separation from their past humiliation. This act declared that they had a new identity. You are no longer who you were. You are mine now. No longer slaves, but free. No longer incarcerated, but you've been liberated. God's message to the Hebrews, remember whose you are. And what is God's message to us tonight? Remember whose you are. Because male or female, Paul would later write that in a real sense, all believers have been circumcised. This might be news to you, but if you walk on over to Colossians 2:11, he wrote to the Christians in Colossae, when you came to Christ, he set you free. Not through a bodily operation of circumcision, but through a spiritual operation, the baptism of your souls. That means that Christ cut away who we used to be. He severed us from our past dysfunctions and predilections. He cut us loose from our former anxieties and phobias. He detached us from their power when we gave our heart to him. It cannot be stated too clearly or too often that you are not the person you used to be, and you are only a fraction of the person you have the potential to be. Your former self no longer exists. When Christ died, you died. When Christ was buried, you were buried. When Christ rose, you rose. You are a brand new you. You should claim it. You should declare it. You should decree it. You should stand on it. Because it's time for you to walk in it. Because even when things are over your head, they are still under his feet. I understand. Because somebody is saying, well, preacher, you don't know me. You don't know what I've been through. But this I do know, that God never wastes a wound. In fact, God finds value in what we are willing to throw away. What one of my sons in the ministry, Dr. Larry Ennis, was talking to me a couple of months ago about his favorite store when he was in seminary. I said, what was it, Larry? He said, man, Walmart was my favorite store. I said, well, why Walmart? He said, well, you know, coming through seminary, I didn't have a lot of money, and so I had a pattern. And it involved Walmart. I said, what did Walmart have to do with it? He said, well, I would use my Walmart bags as a freezer bag, reasoning why pay good money buying Glad bags when I could use them Walmart bags that I got for free. I said, talk to me, man. He said, well, my pattern was the same. Every week I go to Walmart and buy me a family pack of chicken wings. He said, I get them back to my dorm room, break them down into about 4 wings apiece, and then put them in one of them Walmart bags and freeze them. And when I got ready to cook them, they turn out just right. I said, man, that's ingenious. He said, no, you don't understand. He said, those Walmart bags are a multi-purpose bag. I said, what you mean? He said, it can be a tote bag, a laundry bag, a gym bag, a lunch bag, an umbrella, and even a purse. And I know y'all sophisticated and trying not to feel me, but if I went to your house right now, you got some of them Walmart bags in your drawer hanging on your doorknob. See, and Larry pointed out that we keep those bags because we know that after we buy our groceries and put them away, those bags still have value. Come here, because just as we find value in a little Walmart bag, so God finds value in us. He finds value in your problems, value in your pain, value in your pressure, value in your predicaments. God can get something out of everything, and God can use everything to accomplish anything. God can use what hurt you to help you. He can use what set you back to set you up. He can use your rejection to give you new direction if you just remember whose you are.
Okay, that didn't hit you like I needed it to hit you. I've got grandchildren. I've got grandchildren. I pray you live long enough to have a grandchild. I done figured this thing out. I've got 5 grandchildren. I've figured this thing out. That grandchildren are the gift that God gives you for not killing your kids. Y'all get that later on. Amen. See, I've got grandchildren. Y'all ain't old enough. Amen. I've got grandchildren. And my granddaughter, Rachel, just went to kindergarten. And Rachel loves to draw. And so whenever Papa is home, Papa's got to help her draw. And recently, we were in one of her workbooks, and she was just drawing, and I'm just watching, and she was drawing. But I noticed that all of her lines were crooked. So I tried to break it to her easy. I said, baby, this is real good. I said, you draw real good. I said, Ray, this is good, but baby, your lines are a little crooked. And that 5-year-old backed up from the table and said, Papa, I'm doing the best I can. And I said, I understand, baby. I ain't trying to say nothing. I said, well, let me introduce you to something. I said, do you know what this is? She said, no. I said, this right here is called a ruler. Do you know what it's for? She said, no. I said, well, do you see how all your lines are crooked? That's because you are trying to do it all by yourself. What you need is a ruler, because a ruler will help you keep your stuff straight. Come here, somebody. Don't you live another crooked year trying to do it all by yourself. You need a ruler, and I've got a recommendation tonight. His name is Jesus. If you get him in your picture, he'll help you keep your stuff straight. Have I got a witness in here? Is there anybody who can testify that he straightened your stuff out more than once? What do you do before you go into Jericho? How do you survive in spiritually tough territory? You've got to remember what God has already done. But then you've got to remember whose you are. But there's one more lesson. You've got to remember where you are. And where were they? This is going to be so short, most of y'all are going to miss it. Where were they in the text? Listen, almost there. Ooh, that went right over your head. I told you it was a short stop. Don't fall apart when you're almost there. Don't give up when you're almost there. When you're almost there, you're going to be tempted to quit. When you're almost there, you will be knocked down. When you're almost there, you'll be tempted to walk away. It'll seem like everybody around you is getting their blessing before you, but never forget that if God is blessing your neighbors, he's in the neighborhood, and it's only a matter of time before he gets to your house. I need you to shake somebody's hand and say, you almost there, brother. You almost there, sister. Don't quit when you're almost there, because that's what the devil tempted Jesus to do. He tempted him to quit when he was almost there. The enemy tried to make him quit at the Garden of Gethsemane, where his prayers were so intense that his sweat was like drops of blood. He wanted to find another way to get his mission achieved, because I heard him say, Father, if it be possible, let the cup pass, but nevertheless, not my will, but thine be done. This is too hard, too much, too far, and too long. Let the cup pass, but if it's your will, I'll stay in this fight, because I'm almost there. Just a little further, and Judas will betray me. Just a little further, and Peter will deny me. Just a little further, and Pilate will dismiss me. Just a little further, and Herod will condemn me just a little further, and the crowd will mock me just a little further, and the soldiers will beat me just a little further, and my disciples will forsake me. They'll stretch me high and stretch me wide, but just a little bit further, because if I be lifted up from the earth, I'll draw all men unto me. He remembered where he was, that I'm almost at the intersection of justice and mercy. I'm almost at the intersection of truth and love. I'm almost at the intersection of humanity, sin, and heaven's salvation. I just can't give up now. And I'm glad tonight that Jesus didn't give up. Are you glad about it? I'm glad that he went all the way. Because he did, my soul is saved. Because he did, my future is fixed. Because he did, my past is pardoned. Because he did, there is a fountain filled with blood. Without a
amen again. Let the redeeming the Lord shout hallelujah. Come on, let's put our hands together, give God some praise. Amen. Amen. We have been blessed in a marvelous way this evening. Come on, let's give the preacher another big hand of appreciation. Our God has used him in this place. Amen. Brothers and sisters, we have had a marvelous day in the Lord. God has blessed us from our early morning experience with Reverend Jessica Durham, our morning presenter, Reverend Olu Brown, our convocation preacher, Bishop Michael Mitchell, our evening afternoon presenters, Bishop Samuel Green and Bishop Harris Seawright, and this evening, our evening preacher, Dr. Lance Watson. We have truly been blessed this day. Come on, let's give God some praise. What our eyes have seen, what our ears have heard, but most of all, for what our hearts have felt. This day has now come to a close, and we give God praise. We will begin our day in the morning again with our morning glory worship. The Reverend Ronald Slaughter, pastor of the St. James AME Church, will be our preacher. Our worship will be here at the Flipper Temple AME Church, and we encourage you to please come and help us close our activities on tomorrow, starting with our morning glory worship. Dr. Watson will be our final plenary presenter on tomorrow morning at 10, and we invite you to please come and be a part of that. Of course, he will be our closing worship preacher as well. We look forward to what God will do with us and through us on tomorrow, and we invite you to please continue to share with us. The trustee board meeting for Turner Theological Seminary has been canceled. It will be rescheduled at a later time at the request of our chairman. I want to thank the Flipper Temple family for their leadership. Dr. Gregory Easton for hosting us this day. Let's give this choir, these ushers, an thank you so much. Brothers and sisters, we appreciate all that you have done to help make this Founders Day a big success. Now, as we come to the close of this worship, let us all stand and praise God from whom all blessings.
Son, in the name of the Holy Spirit, let us sing together.